Bueno, buenas tardes a todos y todas. Les propongo que no dilatemos más la apertura del acto. Gracias. ¿Cómo? ¿No se oye? Ah, sí, sí. Ah, ya. El tiempo que llegue la electricidad hasta aquí. Bueno, les agradezco que hayan acudido a este acto que inaugura pues el primer Instituto de Estudios Avanzados de la Península Ibérica. Y si miramos más allá de la península, el primer Instituto de Estudios Avanzados, no en América Latina, pero sí en el mundo hispano de América Latina. Entonces, es para nosotros una gran satisfacción concretar 2 años de trabajo, lo comentábamos con Antonio Arbez Osorio, el director del MIAS, que es este día viene a concretar 2 años durante los cuales hemos ido construyendo y trabajando para que vea la luz este primer instituto de la Península Ibérica. Y nada más, yo que lo que quiero decir es que les agradezco estar aquí y agradezco al señor embajador de Francia estar aquí, porque demuestra el apoyo que nos ha brindado desde el principio. Ya para no alargar demasiado, y una vez dicho estas palabras, voy a dar la palabra a Olivier Bouin, que ha sido para nosotros un consejero, un apoyo muy eficiente para ir construyendo a lo largo de estos 2 años este Instituto de Estudios Avanzados que están haciendo y que va a empezar, y que empieza de hecho a funcionar porque ha acogido ya a sus primeros investigadores en octubre y que, claro, con el paso del tiempo va a acoger siempre más. Y Olivier Bouin, que es secretario general del NETIAS, o sea que de una red que agrupa Instituto de Estudios Avanzados en Europa, pues nos va a explicar qué son estos institutos, cuál es el propósito de estos institutos, principios y objetivos a los cuales el MIAS se suma totalmente, obviamente. Merci donc, Olivier, d'avoir accepté de venir pour cette inauguration officielle du MIAS. Et Olivier Bouin va intervenir sur la perspective internationale des instituts d'études avancées. Merci.
Merci. Tout d'abord, je vous dois un mot d'excuse. Je ne peux pas m'exprimer suffisamment bien en espagnol pour pouvoir faire cette présentation en espagnol. Et compte tenu de la présence à la CASA et de l'ambassadeur, je pensais parler en français, mais Michel m'a demandé de vous parler en anglais. Donc, il va y avoir un bilinguisme étrange à Madrid. Donc la présentation que j'ai préparée est en français, mais je vous la présenterai en anglais. Comme ça, je veux dire, tout le monde aura une possibilité de suivre ce que je dis pour les 20 prochaines minutes. Je voudrais remercier avant, et peut-être d'ailleurs si quelqu'un peut mettre la présentation, si on la retrouve sur ma clé, sinon je me déplace. Je voudrais vraiment remercier à la fois les responsables de la UAM, le recteur précédent que j'avais eu la chance de rencontrer il y a un an, le recteur Garese, Antonio Alvarez Osorio, Nicolas Morales, et évidemment Michel Bertrand pour le soutien, je dirais, résolu et l'intérêt, la conviction qu'ils ont montré. Et je voudrais remercier Monsieur l'ambassadeur de sa présence. Je connais la chance de connaître l'ambassadeur depuis 25 ans et c'est souvent, pour ne pas dire toujours, un soutien résolu lui aussi de ce type d'initiative qui vise à promouvoir les échanges intellectuels, les échanges scientifiques internationaux au meilleur niveau de la recherche contemporaine. C'était les quelques mots qu'on m'avait demandé en français. Now we'll switch to English. I'm sorry for especially for the Anglophone colleagues because they will have to support for. Donc il faut que je prenne ça. Voilà. Okay. So this is let's try to figure out. Okay. So the idea in this very brief talk is to present what an Institute for Advanced Study is. And as you will see, there are a lot of different models and different possibilities. It's a very flexible concept, and it can be adapted to very different situations, and it depends basically on the willingness and the interest of the main partners, the founding members of these institutes, to organize the status and the functioning of the institute according to their needs and to what they consider is best fitted for the environment, the academic, scientific, intellectual, economic environment they're operating in. I will show you two slides. First, two maps. The first one is the world map, and these red dots are of Institute for Advanced Study around the world. As you can see, there's quite a high concentration of institutes in Europe, a few in North America. Historically, the model of the Institute for Advanced Study comes from Princeton, founded in 1930. And if you go to if you go to the Princeton Institute for Advanced Study website, you will see that not Princeton for Advanced Study, Institute for Advanced Study, but it would be IAS.edu. It's the Institute for Advanced Study.edu. There's only one Institute for Advanced Study in the world. It's located in Princeton. It's the first one and maybe the most recognized one. But as you can see, this, especially from the 1970s onwards, in Western Europe and increasingly then in the 2000s everywhere in the world, there've been a creation of Institute for Advanced Study almost everywhere. And this is the map of Europe today. You have three colors of dots. The green ones are part of a consortium with my colleague Mylène Trouvé, who is here, the Secretary General of the French Network of Advanced Study Foundation, based in Paris. We've been coordinating since 2010 a consortium of Institute for Advanced Study in Europe. It was the first time there was a kind of pan-European fellowship program, and we started with 12 institutes, and now we are 19 institutes in this consortium. And this consortium is co-funded by the European Commission through the Marie Curie, Marie Sklodowska-Curie action. This year, we placed a call, and we were really happy when, and Antonio will remember the lobbying we made for MIAS to integrate this consortium at a very early stage of its development, so that it would not only benefit of the co-funding, and we have here the first two ERIAS MIAS fellows, and I think we'll have a chance to talk to them after this presentation. But the idea was not only to benefit from some co-funding, but also to be part of a network of other institutes for advanced study in Europe, well-established ones like Berlin, like Amsterdam, like Jerusalem, like Uppsala, and more recent ones, but as you can see, scattered across the European continent, if I may say. Then the red dots are those who are members of the European Network of Institute for Advanced Studies, but that are not part of this ERIAS consortium, for reasons I don't have time to explain now, but you can see some red dots. This means that this is the other institutes, in a sense, that are based in Europe, and most of them are part of NETIAS. And then you have these gray dots like Birmingham, Durham, Tampere. By the way, Toulouse should be also in gray. They are institutes for advanced study, but they are not part yet of this European network. Altogether, the network has 23 members. And it has been, over the years, especially with this fellowship program, this joint fellowship program, I think a good way to know about each other and to develop and foster collaborations across Institute for Advanced Study. And next slide, please. So as you can see, it has been a growing reality over the past 15 years, and what I will try to show, in a sense, is why there have been this, not proliferation, but growing numbers of Institute for Advanced Study, and why various partners, universities, Academy of Sciences, national research centers, or cities or countries have decided to put themselves on this map. And the MIAS project was very much welcome because, as you can see, it was the first one in the Iberic Peninsula. And this was when we had these calls gathering more than 1,000 applications every year, a lot of people were kind of asking why there's nothing in the Hispanic/Lusophone world in Europe, and why you don't have something in this, and say, well, it's not a responsibility to, we just do with what we have, in a sense. So we welcome very much the willingness of Universidad Autónoma de Madrid and Casa de Velázquez to team, to partner, to put a red dot on this map. And that's been very important to attract a lot of fellowship, a lot of applications, and to be able to be in this partnership. So why, in a sense, do you have, why would you create an Institute for Advanced Study? What are the main goals? And here I have identified three. The first one is about international attractiveness. I won't read in English, or I won't translate into English the slides. You can read, but I will give you a little bit of the substance. The idea behind that is to, by focusing on first-class invitation of scholars from a various set of disciplines, to be able to reach out from your university or from your city or from your with your partners, to be able to reach out to other colleagues, other networks, and to help them grow and develop. And this is key to the concept of Institute for Advanced Study, is to have high level privileged mobility, research mobility, so that researchers can embark themselves into blue sky research or curiosity driven research. And having these type of institutes, in a sense, the institute is able to draw on this international mobility market or pool. We have like hundreds of researchers and scholars around the world that we are looking every year for a place to do part of the sabbatical or to develop part of the postdoc research project. And it's important to have the possibility to have an institute that could be the right or the relevant place to go. And this means that in terms of international attractiveness, it's important to be able to reach out to this very high level international mobile community. The second objective is an incubation of new ideas. The idea here, it's complementary to what is existing in universities, especially the best universities. They have already interdisciplinary programs, international programs, so why an institute is different? An Institute for Advanced Study is different because it tries to incubate with, and I will explain that in the next slide, with a mix of formal and informal exchanges within the community of co-fellows to be able to discuss, explore, and sometimes formalize new ideas. New ideas that you would not have the chance to develop in your daily work, in a sense, because you teach, because you are, when you are a university professor, you teach, you have responsibilities for with graduate students, you have like sometimes administrative work to do in your department. So the idea is to open a space, an intellectual and scientific space, in order to have a multidisciplinary and intercultural dialogue. And the idea is to be able to foster and trigger this incubation of new ideas. And we've seen that over the past years, especially the past decades, for the oldest Institute for Advanced Studies that I referred, especially Princeton in the 30s and some large institutes from the 70s onwards in Europe, they have been really able to make a difference in incubating new ideas during the stay of the fellows during 1 year. They've been exchanging a sociologist, a demographer, an economist, and myself an economist, a political scientist, an historian, an archaeologist, then from various countries and various parts of the world by their continuous exchange over a one-year period, they tend to think a little bit in different terms. As you know, as you all know, because you're part of the academic world or the university world, we know that we dig into ever more specialized knowledge and we work on increasingly tiny subjects. What is important is the Institute for Advanced Studies to open and to broaden your scientific horizons by discussing with colleagues not only about topics but about epistemology and methodology, and we think that is a very important dimension of that. And the third objective is related obviously to the second one, is to produce a kind of long-term scientific impact. Yeah, it is not only to have, you know, a great time doing 1 year, and then I go back to my university, I go back to my research lab, to my research center, my Academy of Science, and then I restart again business as usual. The idea is really to produce, and I try to identify at least for the invited scholars in residence, but also and it's something that I will underline a couple of times in the next slides, with also the local researchers. The idea is not to have like a community of fellows in a very privileged, and the Casa de Velázquez, La Autónoma de Madrid, are really very high-level places and very special places in a sense. But the idea is not to bring these people in a cloister or in a place where they would not interact and exchange with colleagues. The idea is to really maximize the exchanges of these fellows, these resident scholars, with the local scientific community. And the idea is really that if you want to produce a long-term impact, this means that this incubation of new ideas will not be only among the co-fellows, but with, and critically with, the local research potential. This means that projects will develop, and this means that, it's my point of view, it will benefit researchers, laboratories, and the partnering institutions, but also it will benefit the enlarging and development of large international scientific networks. And that's something that is important. And fourth, it's also an interesting dimension. Most of the Institutes for Advanced Studies are not only scientific objects, they or scientific institutions. They try to reach out beyond academia, as we say. They try to reach out to what we call in France les décideurs publics et privés. This means like the obviously, depending on the disciplines, depending on the topics, on the research questions dealt with by the scholars, but what we've seen is there's a growing need and a growing dialogue between public decision makers or private decision makers and public at various levels, from the, I would say, territorial governments up to national or supranational decision makers, but also at the level of the private business or more civil society. What is important is that the knowledge produced here in the Institute for Advanced Study would also benefit a larger community. It's not only about like benefiting academia, obviously it's the core aspect of these institutes, but also benefiting a larger community. And in a sense, we recently discussed with partners who were willing to develop an Institute for Advanced Study, and we say, well, in a sense, you're really not incubating, but you're more disseminating, so which is good. And we're not like, this label doesn't mean that what is done outside the label is not good. It's that we want to be specifically important and make a difference on the second level. And we say, well, it's more an institute for knowledge dissemination that you want to develop, which is fine, but it's a little bit different from the Institute for Advanced Study. So very quickly, five main characteristics of the Institute for Advanced Study. It really focuses on individual scientific excellence. That's the cornerstone of all, invitation policies in the Institute for Advanced Study. I don't have time to develop here, but you have like calls for applications, transparent, peer-reviewed. So the idea is really that you will put individual scientific excellence at the cornerstone of the functioning of the Institute for Advanced Study. The second point is very important as well. I will come back to that in a minute, but the third point is important, it's the scientific independence. In a sense, you invite high-level colleagues, but the idea is that the Institute for Advanced Study has some kind of autonomy, maybe not independence, and in this country we have to be extremely careful about the way you use the word autonomy and independence, but this is an institute for advanced study. This is a type of institute that is a bit different from a department's a specialized research institutions working on a topic. So you need to have some kind of flexibility, of souplesse in the functioning, in gathering these individual these excellent individuals and individual scholars. You have to have some kind of autonomy in designing and framing the intellectual and scientific environment for these for these fellows. And this is my second point here, which is my third in the presentation, that an institute of advanced study rests crucially on the creating of an intellectual and scientific community. We invite, or institutes of advanced study invite, colleagues based on individual excellence, but the idea is to create a sense of an intellectual and scientific community. If you want this incubating of new ideas objective to deliver or to function, you need to create the environment that will be propitious or conducive to formal and informal exchanges among the co-fellows and with the associated scholarly community. And you need that to take place, in a sense. You need to have this communauté de savoir et d'apprentissage, it's learning community, even when you have like outstanding scholars and even like senior colleagues, it's a very important moment that they have a possibility to broaden their scientific horizons and to embark into a kind of discussion that they would not have on a regular basis in their department or within the university. And this is something that you need really to constitute this in order to have the benefits or to be able to reach the objectives that you had in mind at the beginning. And this is also related to the fourth element. You need a critical mass to do that. You need to have at least 10 to 15 scholars to have a dialogue, but you need to have, like, if you want to have this dialogue going on over an academic year, you need to have a diversity of disciplines, you have to have a diversity of intellectual traditions in order to exchange and to enrich yourself from the discussion with people with other methodologies, other epistemologies, other intellectual traditions. And we've seen over the past years in France and in Europe, institutes have been really good at that, at nurturing this interdisciplinary dialogue. And for this, you need to have people who are staying at least 3 months, because if they're just coming for 1 week visiting, it's different. You need to have people who are residing a little bit in this institute, at least 3 months, up to 1 year, and you need to have a critical mass of them. Otherwise, the benefits, if you don't follow this type of indication, then you won't be able to deliver on the objective that you had in mind. And then the fifth one is the financial stability. I just want to underline, an Institute for Advanced Study is not a pre-annual scientific program, something that will run for 3 years or 5 years. It's just really to build something that is here to stay, because there's an accumulation of knowledge by the people who are running the institute in nurturing this type of dialogue. I'll try to be quick now. I have two more slides just to make you relax. So you have five common characteristics, but I told you that it's a very flexible model in a sense, and it can adapt to the local or national situations, depends on the intellectual, scientific, academic environment. So here we've listed with Mylène a few dimensions that would just like comment on the thing in bold so that you don't get into trouble if you don't read French. So there's a huge flexibility in terms of forms of organization, of organizational forms or institutional forms of Institute for Advanced Study. You have like very independent institutions with legal personality, full board of directors, scientific board, and own budget, own accounting procedures, and very independent institutions can be even foundations and created as legally independent foundations. And you can go up to something that is a composant d'une université, meaning a part of the university, But with the autonomy that is requested to operate not as a department, but to be embedded in the university, but to have the autonomy to implement an intellectual and scientific program that will help deliver and reach the objective that you have. And you have, like, in between all the, between, you know, on the one hand, highly independent and something that is really embedded in the university, you have all types of forms, and we were discussing this with Michel and Antonio and José Luis Cardozo a few moments ago from Lisboa, and we were saying here, it's a new experimentation in a sense. Une école française, un établissement public with a Spanish university, we've never seen that in the, like, 25 Institute of Advanced Study in Europe. So this means that this model can really is flexible enough to be able to fit to any situation. What is also, what depends is basically the type of relationship you want to have with the local university environment or the national university environment or the national academic environment. And it's, some institutes are really eager to build critically some relationship with universities. Some of them function more as independent institutes and expect some dissemination to take place. So you can, I won't go through all these elements, but I just would like to mention the last two, the last three. The first one is you can be totally relying on blue sky research and just inviting outstanding individual colleagues without any kind of thematic priorities. Some of the institutes in Europe just have blue sky call for applications, and people from whatever topic and disciplines may decide to apply, and it's based on the quality of the research, the researcher, and the quality of the research that he or she will be invited. Some institutes have flagged some thematic priorities or have some collective invitations. And it's something, again, that has to be decided by the institute, by the founding members, by the partnering members, to decide what is the balance between, you know, thematized and blue sky and individual invitations and collective invitations. And the penultimate one is also important. Is also you can have, like, permanent fellows, in a sense, local scholars from your partnering institutions, can be the university, can be other universities, can be national research institutes, that who are permanent fellows. They are not invited annually, but they're part of the scientific environment. They operate as also liaison between the annual fellows and the scientific environment, and also the mix between young postdocs or young scholars and more senior scholars. It all depends on the objective and the interest of the Institute for Advanced Study. What is important is the way the Institute will manage the collegiality across or among the fellows, how they will nurture through this mix of formal and informal exchanges, how they will make this dialogue happen in the community, and also the schemes or the accompaniment, the scientific accompaniment during the fellowship. Some institutes, again, are really hands-on and provide a lot of resources to the fellows. Other institutes are more hands-off and let this function in a more, I would say, natural way across the institutes, across the members. So this is my final slide here. What type of impact you can expect? Obviously, try to reach out to reach the three objectives I stated at the beginning. I think there are rather large positive impact for the fellows themselves. And this is, that's been repeatedly, we have a lot of evidence because we are kind of evaluated every year at the local level, at the national level, or at the European level, and say, okay, what are you doing in these institutes, and how does it benefit the scholars, and how does it benefit the partnering institutions? So it's really based on hard evidence, in a sense. We could provide you a lot of feedback received from fellows who have invited in the French network of Institute for Advanced Study, 800 fellows so far, and we had a lot of very, very positive feedback. Feedback on research and feedback on career. And both levels I won't develop now, but both levels are important for the invited fellows, whether they are junior or more senior, whether they're Europeans or extra-European. We see very positive impacts on their research and on their career. But as you know, funding members or partnering institutions say, okay, that's fine. They get a lot from what we offer, but what do we have at the end of the day by this repeated invitation of scholars year after year? I think you gain, I think, at least at four levels. The first of all is really, this is a label of quality, and in terms of my first objective, the international attractiveness, you really put yourself on the map for this high-level, high-skilled international mobility. And this is something that is important. Scientific excellence, multidisciplinary incubation of new ideas, and international visibility. That's something that this label of an Institute for Advanced Study belonging to this family, rather exclusive family, makes you kind of not upgrade already high-level institutions, but reach out other circles of scientific excellence. So rayonnement international is related to this one, but it's more on the long-term scientific impact and the type of networking that you will be able to do with other institutes of the kind. And we have a meeting next Friday, or this Friday. That's why we have to leave tomorrow morning rather quickly to organize this gathering of the European Network of Institute for Advanced Study to go beyond this joint fellowship program and to try to figure out how we can launch other initiatives. Can be on mobility schemes, on themes. And we will discuss a few themes like the potential of cognition and neuroscience for understanding culture and societies, about the future of Europe, about Muslims or Islam and modernity, or discussing about energy transitions and climate change. So the idea is to put some ideas in the pipeline and try to figure out what are the other institutes would be willing to partner on that. And I think for a rector or for a director of an institute or an établissement like the Casa de Velázquez, I think it's important to be able to locate other partners in Europe with which you would like to develop further collaboration or intensify the collaboration. And if you can remember some of the dots, like you have almost the best universities in Europe that have decided to have an Institute for Advanced Study. So an Institute for Advanced Study can be really a trait d'union, a way to make collaborations, research, doctoral training, summer schools, and scientific programming being developed together. So it also brings a lot of dynamism and international dynamism to new types of networking and projects to be developed. And the fourth one is important, especially in times of budgetary restraints almost everywhere in Europe and outside Europe, is to be able to get access with this kind of new innovative, multidisciplinary international research to get a better access to European and international funding. Not only the funding from the European Commission, we put together and had the chance to present here to the members of the Casa de Velázquez the opportunities for individual and collaborative funding. You have obviously Horizon 2020, the massive European Union 7-year programming for research, but you have a lot of research institutions, international foundations providing a lot of funding, and the scholars and the associated researchers at the local level really benefit from this bringing together these new projects because they get a kind of privileged access to this type of European international funding. So for the partnering institutions, founding members, associated partners, there's a lot to gain in developing this. So I will close now. I was a little bit too long, I'm sorry, maybe 5 minutes too long, but there was also the mental translation between like French, English, and addressing mostly a Spanish audience, so thank you.